Welcome. This video discusses building a user payment flow within the Facebook local currency payment system. Once your products are defined and you've checked that Facebook can see and cache them successfully, you're ready to build the purchase flow into your app, allowing your users to buy your virtual currency or items. Commonly, most apps will implement some form of storefront within their user interface, presenting users with a choice of different items available, typically at different price points. In order to give the user the most natural and native experience possible, you should display your prices in the local currency of that user. So an American user would see prices in US dollars, whereas a British user would see Great British pounds. Of course, this means you need to establish the user's preferred currency up front before you display any store UI to them in your app. Facebook provides this ability through the Graph API. With a user access token, you can query for the currency field on the user object. You'll get back a JSON encoded string which contains the user's preferred currency information. An example of this data is shown here. Notice the user currency field, which contains the internationally standardized three-letter code for the currency. Now that you have this field, you can go ahead and customize your store for the user. Remember, the local currency payment system allows you to specify prices for your items on a per currency basis. This means you can create explicit, nicely rounded prices for your users for whichever preferred currency they've chosen. The next step, when a user chooses an item and clicks buy, is to hook up the Facebook JavaScript SDK to display the pay dialog. This is pretty straightforward. You call the fb.ui method and pass in two parameters. The first is a list of key value pairs that dictate the behavior of the fb.ui call. These are shown here. As a minimum, you need to provide method pay and action purchase item, so Facebook knows to display the pay dialog. Then you specify the URL of your OG product object and a quantity, so Facebook knows what and how much to sell. Optionally, you can additionally provide a request ID field. This becomes your unique identifier for this transaction, and can be used later to query the graph for details on the transaction. If the transaction completes, Facebook will also return to you its unique ID for the transaction, known as the payment ID, but it can be useful to have your own reference as a backup in case the payment flow is interrupted. The second parameter you pass to fb.ui when invoking the pay dialog is a callback function that will receive details from Facebook about the completed transaction. This function is important when fulfilling an order, and will be discussed fully in part 5 of this video series. A full breakdown of the parameters that can be passed into the pay dialog can be found on the pay dialog reference page. Navigate to developers.facebook.com/docs/concepts/payments/dialog for the full details. Here, we're inside the Facebook sample game Friend Smash. If I execute the fb.ui call, you'll see the pay dialog render and offer the user several choices for payment method. By the way, all this code for Friend Smash and the payment solution is fully open source and available for you to download. Check out the FB Samples GitHub page for more information. Now, if I attempt to buy this item using my mobile phone via an SMS that will be charged to my phone bill, you'll see something interesting happen. The original price for this item, which was displayed in the store and is shown under the price field here, was £12.60. However, the total price I'm about to be charged is actually £13. The difference between these two prices, the 40 pence, is listed here as a fee. This fee is created by a scenario we refer to as price jumping. Let me explain. When a user chooses to pay using their phone, their mobile carrier imposes pricing constraints on the amount they can spend at once. These constraints vary from user to user, region to region, and from mobile carrier to mobile carrier, but the result is always the same. This amount that we are looking to charge the user, £12.60, is not an available mobile price point. The user's mobile carrier simply doesn't support a transaction for this amount. Facebook, therefore, is forced to round up the price to the nearest available price point for the user, which still covers the cost of the item. The delta between the two prices becomes the fee that Facebook is forced to charge the user. This creates a pretty poor user experience. If a user sees one price presented to them in your app's UI, and then is charged a higher amount by Facebook, it potentially leaves them feeling confused and frustrated. We therefore need to do some work to eliminate these fees from ever occurring. We can achieve this in a couple of ways. The first is to build your store explicitly for mobile price points. This is discussed in the next video in this series. The second is to support varying quantities at the point of sale. If you are selling a virtual currency, you can choose to be flexible about the amount of currency that you offer to a user at a given time. When invoking the pay dialog, you pass in two additional parameters, quantity min and quantity max. These tell Facebook the minimum and maximum amount of your currency that you are willing to sell. This effectively provides Facebook with a range of prices we can offer to the user. Facebook will then seek to find a price within the range you've specified that matches a mobile price point for that user. Going back to our friend Smash example, we'll change the code to additionally specify the quantity min and quantity max parameters to the pay dialog. We'll save, re-upload, and trigger the purchase flow again. Now we can see the quantity has been adjusted by Facebook. Here, instead of the 210 coins we were selling previously, we're now only selling 200. But notice the user is not being charged a fee, because the £12 price point matches with a mobile price point available to this user. After the purchase process completes, the pay dialog will close and the JavaScript callback specified when invoking the dialog will be executed. A Facebook rendered confirmation will only show to the user after their very first purchase. At all other times, Facebook will simply close the pay dialog and return focus back to your app. It is therefore the responsibility of you, the developer, to notify the user of the outcome of the purchase, i.e. completed successfully, cancelled, or failed due to an error. It's good practice to show the user what they've just bought, as we do here in Friend Smash. For more information, please see the URL listed here. Thanks.